Hi. I would also like to warmly welcome you to this third panel, and I'm happy to introduce our first speaker, who is Mieke Kolk. Mieke Kolk is a theater scholar and author. She held teaching positions in theater studies at the Royal Academy of Arts and the University of Amsterdam. But she was also a visiting professor in the US, in the UK, and in Germany. She specializes in contemporary theater and opera and published numerous reviews, articles, and books on women and theater, music theater, and intercultural theater. Between 1983 and 1988, she was artistic director of the feminist theater group Theater Persona. Besides being a university teacher and theater director, she has been active in the development of intercultural contacts since 2001, running programs on cultural exchange with Arabic and African countries, as well as co-organizing intercultural conferences in Belgium, Morocco, and Sudan. In addition, she has also been an associate lecturer at the University of the Underground, a charity transnational university based in the basement of nightclubs with headquarters in Amsterdam and London. This was a fun fact, but I needed to mention that. Her talk today is entitled Emotional Identification, and we are very much looking forward to your presentation.
Well, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
Well, that is quite outstanding, what you found. I'm so happy to be here because I discover a whole new community here that is existing in this brilliant group of Polish young scholars. I'm excited to know you, and I invited already the whole group to come to Amsterdam, where they will be welcomed by the Amsterdam School of Cultural Analysis. I think you can profit from, both parties can profit from you and new contacts. It is a very good atmosphere. And of course, it's not only the Polish work groups, it's also the other ones. I have some more title. Well, this is me, you know enough. My other title is Reciprocity and Compassion. You know, we all know how you work on a text and it changes from time to time. Since theater is the most public of arts, that is, no public, no theater, theater has always considered its effect on the audience and the public structures of its performances. That is, negotiating, changing social patterns and power relations. Theater makers took part in the general discussion of the 20th century about aesthetics and the politics of art and developed new theories with an exclusive and crucial focus on the living body of the actor. Next to these experiments, the artistic experience in drama and theater, we see from the 1970s on a permanent development of grassroots or community theater that worked with localities and the people that belong there, sharing interests and values. The theater group supplied artistic means and educational techniques mostly to support democracy, emancipation, and to spread information about social important topics. The growth of the new media inspired the use of video films and installations, but also of site-specific performance, and especially important in my experience, the social design projects. I'm not going to talk about this. Have a look at the internet for theater and education, and you will find all an abundance of links to its names and institutions. My website, artsafrica.org, also gives a broad overview of recent applications. This Zurich Symposium focuses on the cultural discourse and art production of the 20th century, and its political agenda to discover new strategies to support acceptance of bodies in displacement, migrants, diversity and differences in new forms of communities. I will only shortly mention this function of art discourses, but further concentrate on the aesthetics in art to explore its specific potency to experience heterogeneity and identification with the other. And there is my first topic. In the art of the first part of the 20th century has been conceptualized under the term historical avant-garde, futurism, constructivism, surrealism, etc., etc. Its main occupation was to bring back art in daily life and vice versa, to touch new audiences and politically to destroy existing bourgeois institutions that stuck to traditions and old power patterns. In practice, these two strategies had two models. First, to give a new content, new topics, stories, new political perspectives, striving to realistic representation of the life of the people, the commons. In this sense, art provided knowledge, and still provides it, about habits, morals, and values of the time. Fundamental in these art forms are truthfulness, reflection of society, and realism, that which French philosopher Jacques Rancière calls successively the ethic and the representational regimes. Model One continues its realistic representation in the 21st century, reflecting actual social topics like identity politics, ethnicity, racism, etc., etc. And globally, migration, climate, city planning, commonality. The second strategy works to deconstruct traditional artistic models and find new forms to make it possible to express changing critical insights and experiences. They do away with the unity of forms, causality, using fragments and collages created from a peripheral perspective. This aesthetic political program was extended in the postmodern philosophical debate, Lyotard. They developed concepts like the end of the grand narratives, micro stories, local rationalities, discontinuity, and pluriformity in art and sciences. It is the artist who mediates in search for the unpresentable and the development of new sensibilities in a complex society. Yes. The second model also discusses the character of aesthetic rules that identify art as art, depending on the way art is experienced. Rancière calls this the aesthetic regime, art experienced with a specific sensorium, a state of being. It is this third Rancière regime that I want to explore, to search for the potency of art to experience other subject positions and identifications on the emotional level, possibly opening up for acceptance of otherness and the other. And if we remember the 18th century Kantian aesthetics in the categories of harmony, beauty, and sublime, we see at the end of the 20th century, aesthetic theory confronted by an imaginarium of the disparate, the divided, the ugly, and the abject. The other half of life, one could say. Yes. Following the first definitions of art, in which he calls the unique power of art, Kraft is the German word, German philosopher Christoph Mencken dismisses the conceptions of art as knowledge, as political, or as critical, and calls these characterizations all attributes of social communication. These crafted desires are different from capabilities. They are spontaneous, pre-subjective, without goal, in play. In short, art is liberating and offers possibility for change, but is deep down neither social, practical or political. Das Ästhetische als Gesamtentfesselung aller symbolischen Kräfte, und das kommt von Nietzsche, ist weder produktiv noch praktisch, weder kapitalistisch noch kritisch. Bad art, is the position of Menke, is art we can assess. The specific sensorium in arts, the body of sensations where our organisms experience and interpret, is not only present in the artist but also in the onlooker. Greek philosopher Aristotle in his 4th century before Christ's reconstruction of the rules of tragedy tries to contain this public experience into concepts that can help us to understand the effects and affect, catharsis and identification. Mostly catharsis is defined as purification from, by fear and compassion by way of identification with the suffering of the hero, the heroine, who is more or less a person like us. It is the ultimate situation, the oorzaak of what art can offer, the as-if situation for the onlooker that enables him, her, a cleansing of two strong emotions. However, what Aristotle dismissed is the scope to move to the edge of and even outside the realm of understanding or to dramatize events whose meaning cannot be encompassed by the logic of probability and necessity. That is Stephen Shankman. Yes, there he is. In Plato and Postmodernism, and theater scholar Hans-Dietz Lehmann in his already famous book, The Post-Dramatic Theater, feels that on, in the argument on, and say that we are now in the period of accepting the right of, again, the disparate, the divided, the absurd, and the ugly. Not only did Greek tragedy and performance negotiate their epic histories from a mythic world into their contemporary time, it did so by a dramatic evocation of both real daily lives, those days of those endless Greek wars, into experiences through fiction, where sudden shock, repulsive and disgusting elements, and bloody scenic text descriptions are hidden and contained by the spectacle of images, bodies, voices, dance, rhythm, and music. It is this double effect of play and part of the cathartic effect of the performance that was picked up by Julia Kristeva. I love her. Do you know her?
Yes.
Oh, so we are on common ground. Well, French color and psychoanalysis. Well, I skipped the whole Lacanian background of her theory because of time, but we can discuss it later if you want it. In what she describes as a confrontation with the abject, the not representable as that what disturbs identity, system, and order. Abjection is pointing to the physiological situation of the in-between, filth, waste, around a corpse. On the outside of the symbolic order, the abject is the space of heterogeneity, of jouissance, where the ego gives up its image in order to contemplate itself in the other. Here, art and aesthetic theory seems to offer space of a possible identification with the other in moments of self-loss and freedom from. Thinking about this liberating process through art of a fixed and idealized identity, I was struck by this comparable process in real life, explained in the trauma theory. Here we meet self-loss again as a result of a shattering event that cannot be fully experienced in the moment and therefore is conscious or unconsciously repeated or reenacted by the traumatized individual. This acting out means being obliged to repeat the repressed material. Working through them not only means confronting the problem, but also to search for articulation. While acting out rejects structure and meaning, working through entails three tasks: reconstructing events and history in a narrative form so that grief and mourning can take place and conditions can be reconsidered. In the artistic practices of today, we meet this articulation between acting out and working through as an actual phenomenon. I offer you first a theater example of a working through a story of grief and mourning in the performance of Gluck's opera Orpheus and Eurydice, directed by Italian Romano Castellucci. Here, the death of the story of the dead Eurydice and the endless grief of Orpheus alone on stage is visually juxtaposed by a live stream showing us a woman in a locked-in syndrome, laying motionless in a hospital bed for dead, somewhere in the country. In a reciprocity of their histories, Orpheus' mourning about the death of his wife evocates the suffering of the other couple and reaches out to us, actual participants in her life / death. Castellucci, who specialized in showing against so-called normalcy, real shapes of the abject. He had two actresses with anorexia, an actor nearly unable to speak, an old man on the stage not being able to hold his poop. He reaches out to extreme experiences of horror, yet turning them into collective mourning and grief that he defends like this. I'm still going to read it. Personally, I do not believe that art has a social function. I'm interested in a politics that is more hidden, not explained. The fact that you belong to a human society, that you are part of a community full of contradictions, is the only frame where art can be created. Art never was connected with purity. It is by definition impure. This impurity, this filth, contains a new value. I think there is no art that is not connected with grief.
Yeah. Well, I have a tape of the opera, but no time yet.
Art and migrancy. I am sure you know all this beautiful quote from Didi Huberman: the image has more often memory and more future than the being that contemplates it.
Über Nachleben gesprochen.
This search for articulation of difference and diversity and the lack of representation hits every minority group in a dominant culture. Strange in all sorts of ways, they are invisible or barred from an adequate cultural representation, deprived of a conscious recollection and a personal history. Being the other, their storytelling shows traces of a traumatic history, acting out in a specific way of telling, a story which, if and when told, could be remembered and mourned. Not longer as outsiders, migrants, migrating artists, are the main category of an international, mostly non-Western participants, and migrancy is the main theme of the Biennale of Sharjah that opened in March 2019. In their work, we can hear the voice of all migrants and see representation of their histories and losses. Titled Leaving the Echo Chamber, the exhibition offered a platform that presented work that engages with local environments but also resonates with global audiences, and here is the text. The Echo Chamber points to the circular network of the new media and also serves as metaphor for, and there we are, historical dominance of capital, cultural, social, and political systems that dictate its success, wooing particular images, languages, skills, histories, and geographies. This the oppression by the Western models in art is still in the minds of the Western, many Western art histories and scholars, and I really would like that put into your attention, because even if the art historians are always busy to trace where the artwork comes from, and even if they look to another work which was made in a total other culture but using a Western model, they declare it as an imitation and they don't look what the difference is in the work of art. Anyway, the healing program, or shall we call it the acting out and working through process, provokes and renegotiates the privileged Western art models. It demands for alternate images, for expanding, bounding narratives by what is hidden or removed, and to reflect on one's own culturally located histories, including rituals, beliefs, and customs. These are some pictures of the Biennale. Miriam Makeba. A home for Miriam Makeba. Maybe I can later tell a bit more, but it's long stories. This is the Otto Bovinanga. And she made in a garden in Sharjah. This beautiful sort of reverberating in colors is the water reflecting every moment different parts. And this is one of the two topics I want to talk a bit more about it. This work is The Starving of Sudan, in an installation. One of this provoking art moving and moving artworks is the installation of Chinese artist Zhu Chen. You will probably all recognize this horrifying abject picture. It's from 1994. The Starving of Sudan, a vulture watching a small girl lying for dead in the Sudanese desert. Made by American journalist Kevin Carter, the picture evoked worldwide discussions about ethics. How could he have left her there without helping? Kevin Carter killed himself. In 2008, Chinese artist Zhu Chen uses the picture again, turned it into a critical and repetitive performance. He finds a black girl and the mother, and he makes new photographs of the girl getting up and walking to her mother. No, this is not. This is the only thing I can show you. The vulture is artificial this time, it's a stuffed bird. Members of the audience, especially women, again protested against this instrumentalization of the girl and her new mother used in art. Attendants of the performance take pictures again and put them on the internet. Again, the artist's question is about ethics, empathy, and the passive participation in world tragedies. As an artistic strategy, he mocks the universal desire for good endings in fiction as impossible in real life. And now I need your help. I first have a small text, yes? In the section Making New Time of the exhibition, we can watch a small part of the 15 minutes animation film of Michael Rakowicz, The Ballad of Special Ops Cody. Puppet soldier John Adams, a gift for children of the USA military staff in Kuwait and Iraq during the war, visits in his uniform the Oriental Institute of the University of Chicago, climbs to the vitrines of very old Mesopotamian votive statues taken away during earlier colonial wars, and invites them to be free and leave the museum. Double-coded, real and not real, they all represent the mute, the dead, the false liberators, aggressors and victims, the here and there, present and past, both good-willing prisoners of the system, helpless, petrified, and afraid, fixed in another's history. They brought tears in my eyes. We're finished. 1.5 minutes.
I'm sorry. Why do you look at me like that? Like we're different. Look, I said I was sorry. We're not different. I mean, we are, but we're also the same. Because both of us, all of us, we were created. We were sold and stolen, or stolen and sold, to a destination unknown that's not our home. We shouldn't be here. We have stories to tell to our families, our friends, in our own native tongue. We have stories to tell. What's your story? Just keep talking. I just keep talking. I guess to myself. Because you're not answering. You guys. Why are you here? Don't y'all want to go home? Be free? And get y'all out of here. Now's your chance.